Mics, the Fat Boys, Harry Belafonte, Whitney Houston, and a host of others gathered at Wembley. This time, the banner was not hunger, but freedom.
I think basically this is a consciousness-raising event. You know, people can find out about South Africa, about Nelson Mandela, and make their own choice. No one is preaching up here. They're just presenting information. So, I don't know. I think it'd be nice if this had an effect in South Africa, because I think it's South Africans themselves that have to change their country, you know. We can shout all we like, but it's up to them. They have to do it. You know, this event could only happen in the 20th century. You know, it's basically an invitation to the South African government to say, join the 20th century. Dismantle apartheid. It's inhuman, it's illogical, and it's cruel.
Why are you here?
I'd say that was fairly obvious, actually.
No, your own personal reason.
Well, my personal reason is the same as everybody else. Anyone who objects to apartheid, Nelson Mandela stands for protest against that apartheid. 25 years is a long time.
I've never been one to sort of like get involved with causes and stuff too much, because you've got to, you know, really sincerely back them up. But like this, I felt when I was asked to do it, you know, that. I mean, if you saw the film about a guy, you know, about 2 months after he got married, he was put in jail, right? And, you know, I was incarcerated one time for just 36 hours, and I know the agony of that.
Today is Nelson Mandela's birthday, but we also celebrate the fact that we know in very little time we'll be celebrating the ending of apartheid in South Africa. As when I had the first march, as we demanding for the national holiday for Martin Luther King, I imagined, as when I wrote this song, the reality of the day when we would all celebrate his birthday, because he stood for the fabric of every American, every culture of people. Well, this, as we talk about freedom of people and a one South Africa, is for that same freedom.
Sing it with us, come on.
Freedom for a repressed people from the evils of apartheid in South Africa is an ambitious pursuit for those who are not political figures, but instead singers, dancers, and music makers. But in one sense, a very tangible goal was reached, that of making Nelson Mandela as prominent a household name as the stars who littered the bill.
Can you tell me what this concert means today?
Well, it means a stand for anti-apartheid, mm-hmm. You know, our contribution to helping to get rid of this terrible, terrible situation that happened in South Africa.
People want Nelson Mandela to be freed, and my coming here means it's my own way of, you know, giving solidarity to Nelson Mandela and the people of South Africa.
Can you tell me how important this concert is today?
It's probably the best thing that anti-apartheid movement have ever done. I mean, so many people are going to see it, and so many people are going to become aware of all the things that are happening. It's brilliant.
G'day, mate. How are you?
What do you think this concert stands for today?
Well,
against apartheid?
Yeah, that's it. But I guess it's more for fun. And that's it. That's a way to do a show. That's perfect.
So you're here for the music and not the political?
Well, both of it, but more for the music.
Huh? How about you? Yeah, same as you.
Do you know what this concert's all about today?
Get in blitz with lads.
That's it? Do you know who Nelson Mandela is?
Just as some guy who's locked up for being a terrorist, like.
He's locked up for being a terrorist?
Yeah. Piss off.
Why is this event important, do you think?
Why is it important? Because what's going on in South Africa is ridiculous, really. Everyone's human, you know? There's some that are strong, there's some that are weak. And what the whites are doing there are just suppressing the blacks. You know, there's enough to go around. There's no need for this. So with all these stars getting together, it's just showing the world that more and more people are beginning to stand against it. And, you know, we all paid our 25 quid. And we're going to show everyone out there that we care. And Willie Mandela, we're with you all the way.
Last-minute preparations for the concert in London contrasted sharply with events in South Africa. A three-day strike by almost 3 million black workers turned South African cities to ghost towns. At midnight on the day of the concert, South Africa entered its third year in a state of emergency. Among other things, the state of emergency permits detention without trial, gives wide power to security forces, imposes draconian restrictions on the media, and permits the banning of organizations and persons. One such organization is the unofficial opposition party, the African National Congress, of which Nelson Mandela, although incarcerated for over 25 years, is still a most powerful leader. In Britain, the Freedom at 70 concert was a major press event. Leading anti-apartheid figures such as the Archbishop Trevor Huddleston joined with show headliners to ensure that the right message got across.
As we speak, there are people being tortured, people being killed, people being oppressed in the most real sense. You know, they have no human rights. And that's not even to speak of the violence that means to grow up in extreme poverty. And now and then you hear someone say, or a lot of times you hear someone say, that there won't be any change until there's a bloodbath. And obviously, people who work for peace don't want to see that. People who work for social change want an end to the violence.
Jackson, you're a person who has all your life been aware of world politics and the need for global change. Can you point to any sort of tangible results that you think the power of music has made?
Yeah, music has the power to sort of help coalesce public opinion and generally reflect public mood. I don't think that, I think it's a little over-optimistic to think that it has the real power to initiate change. Generally reflects sentiments and moods and passions that exist in the population already. And yeah, I think that it has a very powerful role to play.
The New Music Special Edition, Sing a Song of Freedom, will continue with a look at the development and last-minute problems behind the Nelson Mandela Freedom at 70 concert.
There's been pressure on the BBC in this country, who are showing the whole of the event, and their pressure has come from the South African government.
It was seen in 60 different countries by over 200 million people. It was a global birthday greeting to a man who is serving life imprisonment for preparing to overthrow the apartheid state. Campaigning for the release of political prisoners is not unusual for people like Jerry Dammers and Jim Kerr. Jerry Dammers in England organized the Artists Against Apartheid group, and Jim Kerr and Simple Minds spent a world tour campaigning for Amnesty International. The Freedom at 70 concert boasted no Geldof-like figure in the absence of Nelson Mandela himself, but Simple Minds was the first band to commit, and Jim Kerr became a solid for your involvement on such a scale now.
Essentially, I think this time last year, I was in London doing a series of things for a live album, and one journalist I came across, it was a particularly good interview because it got all kind of heated, and during the course of the interview, we touched on Amnesty International and, you know, our involvement in that and the whole thing with the political prisoners. And I guess I had happened to say off the cuff that I felt Mandela kind of symbolized all of the political prisoners, although he himself probably wouldn't want to be singled out. I had said that there's a journalist passed that on to Jerry Dammers, a person I'd never met, but had a lot of respect for him. And he was on about putting on a concert at Wembley. This was in June last year. He was talking about putting on an anti-apartheid concert for September, essentially 3 months later. And although I liked his, you know, courage, he sounded nervous and he sounded a wee bit out of his depth. I'm sure he wouldn't mind me saying that. Too bad if he does. But anyway, I met him and he got going and stuff, and I said, it's crazy, you know, because all he had was the idea. He didn't even have a promoter at the time or anything. So he came back about to November. He had a promoter in this guy called Tony Hollingsworth, who had all the experience of the big CND festivals we have commit ourselves. And also Ed Bicknell, who manages Dire Straits, heard some rumblings of what was going on. He got in touch with our manager and said, if Simple Minds to commit Dire Straits, well, then I guess that was, you know, the cornerstone of the event.
Unrealistic to suppose that Jerry Dammers was out of his depth. In 1986, Jerry organized the successful Freedom Beat concert in London. It featured name artists and attracted 500,000 people, but it lost the anti-apartheid movement approximately £70,000. The Freedom at 70 concert for Nelson Mandela was also not without hitches.
There's been pressure on the BBC in this country, who are showing the whole of the event. And their pressure has come from the South African government, who've said, how can they support an event which is supporting an organization which has not given up, revoked violence, and so on, and all of that sort of thing. Now, it's a sort of outrageous attempt to interfere with what the BBC do in this country, and it won't succeed.
The South African government has appealed to what they call the highest authority to have the BBC put a stop to carrying the show.
Well, I don't find that a big surprise, do you?
No.
I mean, I don't really know what to say to that. It's entirely predictable. We could have, you know, we could have sat down and written out a scenario 2 or 3 weeks ago. That would have been one of the things that one would have written out. One could also sit down and write a list of the names of people who would be vocal in their opposition to an event such as this.
You made a very firm statement last night upon the stand of Great Britain on South Africa. Uh-huh. Can you? Why did you do that on stage on your tour?
Because I knew I couldn't do it today on television.
Why not?
Because we were told not to.
From the research I've done, even if they did pull it, they're already under contract that everywhere else in the world has to get it. So we wouldn't get it in England, but maybe that would be a good thing as well. It caused a little stir. Mm. And as I've heard, yeah, there's delays and this and that. There's a 7-second delay to stop people. I mean, what country is this? Mm. Is this Russia or what? I mean, what are they so afraid of? None of them have bothered, you know. I think this propaganda as well, trying to make us, but none of them even bothered to check out the songs or the lyrics. And if they did, I'm sure they would find no talk of terrorism or uprising or the bloody revolutions or anything like that. But I'll be very aware on stage. I'll leave my soapbox at home, but I'll be very aware that there's a kind of golden opportunity here. And I'm not going to let it pass me by.
I think the pressure that it's putting on South Africa has already made itself very evident. I think the South African government has tried desperately to stop the BBC from putting this on the air, trying desperately to stop from this message being sent to the 60 countries that have tuned in to our satellite to carry this event. I think already we know that we have touched a nerve that it is very important for us to touch.
No matter what the South African consulate says, no matter what Mrs. Thatcher says, the fact of the matter is that apartheid is wrong. Now, I haven't said anything political, have I?
Sing a Song of Freedom, a new music special edition, takes a look at how the proceeds from the Nelson Mandela concert will be used. Next.
I do not endorse violence, so I would wish for this money not to go towards weapons.
In northern London, when in fact it's a very special street because it houses the London office of the African National Congress. These are the offices, and you sort of need to know where you're going because there isn't a big headline announcing the fact that the African National Congress is here for obvious reasons. The ANC is dedicated to the destruction of apartheid and its replacement by a new democratic and non-racial political and social order. The ANC was founded in 1912 and advocated a peaceful resolution to its struggle for 50 years until it was forced underground and accepted an armed struggle.
There are many people who feel
that it is useless and futile for us to continue talking peace and non-violence against a government whose reply is only savage attacks on an unarmed and defenseless people.
The organizers of the Mandela concert have decided not to give the money to the ANC. How did you react to that?
The organizers are, of course, not, we are not part of the organization process, and we were informed when the concert was organized that circumstances necessitated that they give the funds only to charitable organizations.
What circumstances?
I think the charity laws, probably the political climate in Britain. I mean, we, of course, accept it. I mean, it's not our concert. We have not organized it, and we accept the decision of the organizers.
But they have made a very simple distinction, and that is that they don't want to support the armed struggle. It's a violence versus non-violence.
Well, the anti-apartheid doesn't have that problem, because the anti-apartheid over the years have accepted the legitimacy of the armed struggle in South Africa. It's possible that some artists might not accept that the armed struggle. And it's also possible that some of the organizers might not accept the armed struggle, but the anti-apartheid as a movement have accepted the armed struggle. The South African people have made clear that we will use any method to achieve our freedom. We have always used non-violent, militant but non-violent struggle to try to achieve our independence. Our organization was banned in 1960. 2 years later, when there was no other way, constitutional way of fighting for freedom, we adopted the armed struggle. Since then, in 1977, 17 organizations, mainly black consciousness organizations, were banned. In February 88, another 17 organizations have been banned. And the South African regime has made it illegal to fight against apartheid by any other means but by adopting the armed struggle. So we have adopted the armed struggle not because we love violence, but as a means to end violence of the apartheid system.
Tell me why this event is so important to you.
I think he's a symbol for people who are in prison for their ideas, you know, and I think he's 70 years old and he deserves to be let out under a no compromise as a citizen of South Africa with all the rights that he deserves. It's not to say I support the ANC, I don't. I'm for the peaceful dismantling of apartheid, and this event is about that.
It's dangerous. I mean, you know, when you talk about the ANC, you're talking about both, you know, the political and military wings, and you know, once it goes there, you're never very sure. And I think a lot of artists wouldn't have done it if they knew that there was money going towards the military side. And I think it's a lot better, the money that's coming from it is going to like children's organisations and things, you know, people that are, you know, directly affected rather than just the cause. I mean, this is doing more for the ANC than the money, I think.
I do not endorse violence, so I would wish for the money not to go towards weapons. However, you know, there are so many examples, I mean, such as, say, Israel, where there's a certain hypocrisy because the people in power were once terrorists using violence, and in a few years down the line, all the governments start talking to them, and it's seen as a means to an end. I was really encouraged at the situation in Zimbabwe, because the basic transition from white to black was fairly free of fighting, and hopefully the South African government may see that they can't stop 4/5 of their population from having no say in the running of the country. I mean, that situation has to come to an end.
You stand up to him any way he chooses. Conflict if he likes, but with an open hand too. To say that we can all build a South Africa worth living in. Purpose. A South Africa for equals.
September 77, Port Elizabeth, weather fine. It was.
What's your name, Kevin?
As usual.
Ben.
Say it!
Say your name!
Peter Gabriel's song Biko was re-released in 1987 to coincide with Richard Attenborough's film Cry Freedom. The type of attention Cry Freedom attracted was sorely needed, considering the lack of journalistic information that escapes the country under the state of emergency and its restrictions on the freedom of the press.
Very, very little real information is coming out. We pay tribute to those journalists who are still trying to beat the censorship by trying to expose certain aspects of what's going on. But in reality, very, very little is coming out of what is happening in South Africa. The actual reign of terror is unprecedented. Little information of that is coming out. The alternative newspapers, two have already been banned, and the government has warned another five that action is going to be taken against them. So the government is clamping down on all possibilities of bringing out information, and we are very conscious that the world is only getting what the regime wants the world to get at the moment.
What kind of impact did the Sun City project have?
Firstly, Sun City in the Bantustans in Bobo-Tswana has been used as a base to defeat the isolation of South Africa politically, culturally, economically. The campaign that started in the States, the general campaign internationally against artists going to Sun City, was welcomed not only by us, but I think by almost all the major artists and cultural organizations in our country.
Sun City is the showplace of Bophuthatswana, one of the so-called independent homelands where South African blacks have been relocated. It's a lavish resort where you can relax and enjoy some of the world's headline entertainers. It's part of the reality of apartheid.
Song of Freedom, a new music special edition, takes a look at the continuing debate over the effectiveness of the cultural boycott of South Africa. Next.
That there's been a broad new dimension given to the whole situation of cultural boycott.
Involvement in the struggle against apartheid. We question the cultural boycott, wondering whether music could be treated in the same manner as economic commodities like fruits or minerals. Should musicians practice a form of self-censorship, or should they allow their voices to be heard, lending their spirit to the struggle? A song as powerful as Ain't Gonna Play Sun City blasted to the heart of the politics. It made people aware and it showed solid support. So the new music asked the question, what's more effective, cultural boycott or cultural support?
I think, like you, I think like most people, it's hard to sort out on these questions of boycott. What works, what doesn't work, what the impact is, measurable or minimal, how it all comes together. And I think the basic rationale for the cultural boycott, for a sports boycott, for an economic boycott, it's all the same. It is to deliver a message to the South African regime that what they are doing is detestable, that the government imposition and application of apartheid is an offense against humanity, and that it has to.
Simon's Graceland and the concert that he's put on in the United States and in Europe and in England has had a great impact upon focusing people's attention to South Africa beyond the politics of the country. It shows its culture, and not so much in the album, but certainly in the platform that Paul Simon gave to these South African artists, one gets an opportunity to hear a lot of political songs and political material. So the politicizing of Europeans and North Americans is the saving grace of Graceland.
On the one hand, I think the cultural boycott is effective because it makes a very clear, simple statement. On the other hand, I'm not sure that it actually is. I'm not sure that who it is that we're boycotting. I think it would be good to get our ideas over there and expressed. I think it would be good for our artists to do it.
These are the days of miracle and wonder. This is the long distance call. The way the camera follows us in slow-mo. The way we look to us all. The way we look to a distant constellation that's dying in a corner holidays, miracle, wonder, and don't cry.
A lot of the people really didn't understand why he went down there to record. He could have recorded in Zimbabwe and avoided all these problems. The unfortunate part is it became a massive distraction from where we'd like to be as far as having these discussions about the economic boycott, which is the most important part of it. But instead we have to discuss the cultural boycott, which is far less important, but nonetheless connected.
Now, it's been 2 years since you released Ain't Gonna Play Sun City. Has it had any sort of tangible effect on the place itself, do you think?
Oh, absolutely. We shut them down for international acts. No one of any significance has gone since the record came out. We certainly have made the connection finally between the cultural boycott and the economic boycott, and everybody's starting to realize, well, we can all work together on this, whatever we do for a living. It's not only boycotting the Shell oil gas station, but it's also not going down there to perform. And now it's time to spread it into like the golfers who are still going down and the race car drivers. I mean, they're virtually the only ones left. Very soon, once the isolation is complete, the apartheid regime will fall.
I guess that Paul Simon is the best example of the type of controversy that can develop from the idea of a cultural boycott. Where do you stand on that?
I really don't know, but I'll tell you why. I'll tell you both. Instinctively, I think if you're asking for people to sanction, you know, asking for the big companies who really are keeping the money there, it seems hard to say, well, you pull out when we won't pull out. Anyway, in our next album, we won't have that problem because we've written a song called The Mandela Day, and by doing so, the record will immediately be banned, so...
that's your way of dealing with it.
That's that.
I personally have asked for my records not to be released. Where I don't agree with the cultural boycott is that it has actually meant that some artists from South Africa have not been able to express themselves in this country or in other countries, and I think that is where the cultural boycott screws up, because the writers, the musicians, the performers, their voice needs to be heard and shouldn't be restricted by any unions in these countries. But I think it is wrong for rich Westerners to go and make millions out of Sun City. And I really hope that the record boycott will help to speed about the process of change.
What?
See, I think I should art and popular music is, you know, it is an art form. I think it's a really valuable weapon, and I don't think it's the same as Shell petrol or something like that, or BP. They would tell me differently. They say you're bullshit. It's all product. You're all making money from there. But see, they don't like it when it's art. They don't like it when it's songs. You know, you can't take a tank to a song and blow it away.
Mm.
You can't. And when you see all these kids down there in the townships singing "Free Nelson Mandela," I know how I feel. Never mind Jerry. What a success. You know, they've never liked when the artists or musicians have started getting uppity. They've never liked that since, you know, Jericho.
You just recorded your latest album in Africa. Do you anticipate any pressure because you have effectively contravened the cultural boycott?
Well, the album was recorded in Africa, South Africa. Unfortunately, I was not permitted to go because I am a political undesirable. I was not given a visa. But there's been a broad new dimension given to the whole situation of cultural boycott. Both the ANC in its official announcement, both the UDF in South Africa, I think the anti-apartheid movements all over the world, including the United Nations, especially at the symposium which is being held on the 2nd, 3rd and 4th of September in Athens, convened by the United Nations in order to redefine the whole issue of the boycott, you will find that there is now a much broader caveat. There's a much broader base for interpreting what is considered to be supportive of the anti-apartheid system and what is not supportive of the anti-apartheid system movement. I think that what I've done and what Paul Simon did and what others will do is not in the service of Botha. I think it was in the service of the struggle for the liberation of the peoples of South Africa. I think that definition will prevail. I don't anticipate any problems, and if we do have them, I'll meet them as they come.
Next on The New Music, the day after the Nelson Mandela concert, Glasgow, Scotland plays host to a massive anti-apartheid rally and the start of the Freedom March.
Oh, we'll set Mandela free.
This is an emergency demonstration to call the public's attention to what's going on in South Africa. We are pledged to stay outside this embassy day and night around the clock until Nelson Mandela is free. And in fact, we've been here for over 25 months now.
The word casualties comes up a lot. And in South Africa, they seem to make it feel like there's a battle against between isms going on, between one good ism and one bad ism. But what they're talking about is nightly South Africans died, casualties. There were 8 more casualties in South Africa. Nothing casual about dying. Nothing casual about standing for freedom. My grandmother used to say, if you don't stand for something, you'll go for anything. We stand against apartheid. Stand against apartheid. Let me see you.
Whether it's black and black violence or not, the violence, the state violence and terrorism of the Botha regime goes without question and without any argument.
For those people that thought that the campaign to free Nelson Mandela ended at Wembley Stadium when the music died down, think again. The very next day in Glasgow, Scotland, 20,000 people gathered at a rally to begin the Freedom March.
The people who are in charge.
Amandla! Amandla!
25 marchers, each one symbolizing 1 year of the 25-year imprisonment of Nelson Mandela, will march 590 miles from Glasgow to London's Hyde Park, arriving there on July 17th, Mandela's birthday. Glasgow was the first city to honor Mandela with the Freedom of the City and hosted the rally that welcomed notable anti-apartheid leaders, including the Archbishop Trevor Huddleston, president of the anti-apartheid movement, and Oliver Tambo, president of the African National Congress.
Today's demonstration in Glasgow is the biggest anti-apartheid movement demonstration ever in Scotland.
They have thrown us in prison, they have murdered us, they have tortured us, they have tried to intimidate us into silence. And they thought that you would forget. You have come to say today that you did not forget and that you are still with us in this battle, and we thank you for that. I have a feeling, my brothers and sisters, that our time has come. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what P.W. Botha says, our time has come. It doesn't matter what Margaret Thatcher does, our time has come. It doesn't matter what Kuhl does not do or cannot do or will not do, or that Reagan is on his way out and still refuses to do, our time has come. And we will save it.
It was 25 years ago this very day. Behind the walls all through night and day. Let the children know the story of their man. And I know what's going on right through your land. 25 years ago.
What signs do you think that show you that the foundations of apartheid are crumbling?
The divisions that are taking place among those who were once monolith in defense of apartheid, the splintering that has taken place, the confusion
in the ranks of the government, the lack of direction is because the foundations have been attacked and are cracking up. So we know that, and we are certain, that what is necessary at this moment is a more resolute, determined push, and the structure will collapse. Now that push must come from the internal forces as well as the external forces. And that's all that remains of apartheid. The regime has become desperate, of course, and we must not mistake new pressures and more violence on the part of the regime as showing it strong. It shows the opposite. It shows they are desperate. The reason they are shooting children, nobody ever wants to shoot children, is because they had reached this point of desperation. They can't hold this thing. So the more they ban people, the more they restrict the press, the more they do any of these things, the more they are feeling weak and are acting in desperation.
Historically, Canadians have voiced strong opposition to apartheid.
If there is no progress in the dismantling of apartheid, our relations, those of Canada with South Africa, may have to be severed absolutely.
In 1985, Canada stopped all official support for trade and investment in South Africa. And in terms of the concert event at Wembley, Canada's Brian Mulroney was the only Western leader to send official greetings to the anti-apartheid movement. Most recently, however, at the economic summit in Toronto, efforts by Canada that may have encouraged stronger economic sanctions by summit participants against South Africa were defeated, and Canada settled for a mild condemnation of apartheid.
We declare our abhorrence of apartheid, which must be replaced through a process of genuine national negotiations, by a all legal options available in South Africa should be used designed to deprive anti-apartheid organizations of overseas aid would place severe strain on the relations each of us has with South Africa.
The posture of Canada on the question of sanctions has been encouraging to us because when the Commonwealth discussed this matter in the Bahamas, Canada was very strong. In subsequent discussions, Canada has been consistently demanding comprehensive sanctions. And we have said the Canadian government and people should actually go ahead and impose comprehensive sanctions, challenge the rest of the members of the Commonwealth, challenge especially Great Britain. And if Britain is really committed to the continued existence of the apartheid system, naturally, the British government won't touch apartheid. They will apply no pressures. They'll content themselves with condemning the apartheid as if that has ever made any difference with the apartheid system, as if that will ever make any difference. It's almost purposeless these days to say you condemn apartheid. What effect has it had? What effect has it had over the past 40 years of apartheid? Nothing.
The New Music Special Edition, Sing a Song of Freedom, will be right back with some final comments from Jim Kerr, Natalie Cole, and Cry Freedom star Denzel Washington.
Do not buy from companies who refuse to divest in South Africa.
With thousands of marchers and millions of supporters all over the world, all crying with one voice, free Nelson Mandela. What do we do about a government who won't respond to the pressures of the global community, all demanding an end to the horrors of apartheid? What possible effect could hundreds of singers and artists have on a regime that's blind to basic human rights? The artists may not have all the answers, but they can express the hope.
Raising consciousness is what it's all about, and I think that the government in South Africa is so afraid of this man who's on the inside and still able to make a difference, then there will be some changes made after today. I think that they probably won't let him out because the man does not want to be let out under any conditions. He wants to be let out and continue to do what he has been doing. He's willing to die for what he believes in, and you have to respect and really be very in awe of an individual like that, and that's why we're here.
When the people who actually are sitting at home and are at this event when it happens on Saturday, when it's over and when they go back to their regular lives doing what they're doing, what can they do as people to actually make sure that the
sanctions,
sanctions.
Do not buy from companies who refuse to get to divest in South Africa. It is working. I was talking with Nelson Mandela's lawyer yesterday. We did an interview together. And even I was, not to say skeptical, but I was misinformed about the strength of sanctions. And he's saying to me over and over and over again, it works. So if there's any message I can say to people, it works. Sanctions, sanctions, sanctions.
We are not presumptuous enough to feel that music can free the world or even South Africa, but all we know is that this concert will help to raise consciousness of all the people around the world. And we thank everyone who has participated in this concert. We have friends all over the world. I'm talking as a South African. It is wonderful to know that so many people care about the problems we have in my country. This concert means a lot to us as South Africans because we have a saying in my country, in my language, umuntu, ngumuntu, ngumuntu. You are a person only because you're surrounded by other people.
10, 15, 20 years time, I don't know how long it will take, but when we look back and see the footage of what's going on in South Africa, I hope, pray that it's no longer what's going on. I think it's going to seem as banal as when you see footage from Europe in 1945 or whatever. I think it's going to, and when you see that now, you think, what all that Auschwitz and all that stuff? What did people do? What did the international community? Well, I mean, what did you do? And it's important to me when I see that, that even more important to me because I have a microphone, I had the chance to say something. It's important that I voiced my protest.
When the rising sun sets Mandela on his way, held behind four walls all through nights and days, from the ones outside to the one inside, we say, oh, Mandela free.